that can be used to rectify that disconnect, we're all for. And to that end, we're developing a dialogue series that we'll be conducting throughout the year. We're of the belief that you can't understand other people's, other cultures, people that don't look like you without consistent dialogue. And so we intend to develop these dialogue series that we'll be conducting out throughout the year, probably every other month, if not more frequently, in every part of Tulsa. We're not going to do it, say, in this downtown area and expect people to come to us. We're going to take dialogue sessions to them. And so we hope that all of you here participating tonight would also participate in these dialogue series when we show up in your neighborhoods, in your community. So welcome and enjoy the discussion.
George J. Scott and Sonny Clark use textile techniques to address the need to highlight challenge, uncover and discover race, identity, and justice. The artists fearlessly portray their own histories and realities in a way that nudges us towards a more compassionate approach to the African American experience. Our idea of bringing together artists from different disciplines and backgrounds to talk about the art, and talk about how art can be used as a vehicle to address difficult issues, arose from early discussions with Ruben, Alicia Latimer, Charlie Money, and Dr. Dickens. The exhibition is a starting point for a conversation by local artists from different disciplines about their experiences towards creating a language that encourages understanding. We invite you to be a part of the discussion. Our facilitator, Dr. Dwayne Dickens, will tell us how the evening will proceed and a little about himself. Dr. Dickens.
Thank you. Now, I'm going to sit with you, and I am a professor of English at Tulsa Community College, and I'm also connected with both OCCJ and the John Franklin Center at Social Justice Science, and I work with those because I know that conversation is important. And so we're sitting at a table. So I want you to think about this. So if you're sitting at this table with us, and we're going to start a little conversation with the panel members where they tell us a few things about themselves. After they tell a few things about the works that they do and what it means, then you're going to have an opportunity to share with people in the room with you. So you're at a table, a pretend metaphorical table, and you're going to talk to one another for a few minutes about what they say. So please listen to what the artists are going to share. If you cannot hear us, please raise your hand and say, I have no idea what you're saying because you're not talking to the mic. We do not mind that because we want you to hear and feed off of the wisdom that these artists will share today. So let's start with Eyakem, and he's going to share briefly what his art is and what you should know about that in terms of this backdrop as well.
First of all, thanks so much, Runaway. I value this type of connection. It is one thing that we lack today. By the computer and have that kind of discussion of not to be. Anyways, with that said, I use photography as a tool to sort of engage my own personal narrative as an American into 19th century American history. So I'm pretty much influenced by 19th century American history and the use of photography in propagating America. So this includes exclusion, particularly interested in the African American experience and sense of identity and how they form their own landscapes, so to speak, and the memories of America.
Hi, my name is Sterlin Harjo. I'm a filmmaker from here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm Seminole and Creek from those two tribes. And I'm a filmmaker. I have made three narrative feature films, a feature documentary. I have a comedy group that I started called the 1491s. It's pretty popular. We started on YouTube. We are now commissioned to write a play for the Oregon Shakespeare Company. And I think that the way that I've always approached my work, as a person growing up, I grew up in rural Oklahoma, and you know, Native American representation is so far behind a lot of things that it's sometimes radical to show Indian in blue jeans, you know, or like a Native person in in a modern context. So, you know, for me in my work and my films especially, I've just tried to tell human stories and show contemporary Native people with complexities, with light and darkness, just like every human has, because we're at such a disadvantage. I mean, with Native people, you know, from day one, whether it's the beginning of cinema, whether that's dime store novels in the 1800s, we've been portrayed as something that we're not. And part of that portrayal, I think, was so people felt good about the genocide of our culture. So I have constantly just tried to tell real, compelling stories. And then, you know, through YouTube, this invention of YouTube, I started doing these comedy videos with this group of Native American. We weren't comedians, none of us were comedians, we just thought we were funny and we decided to do funny videos. And what we discovered after we started putting it out is there was this vacuum, this void of Native humor, which is a really big deal. Like, if you ever hung out with Native people, you know they're not stoic, they're really funny and they're loud, and, you know, it's a good time. And so once we started putting these videos out, they became popular, and I think because there was this void of Native humor that we filled. And the good thing about comedy is you can address social issues directly. Because it's all about the package in which you deliver your message in. If you deliver it, you make someone laugh, they're gonna listen more than if you're, you know, yelling at them or something. So it's been an interesting path of like making these feature films that are very serious and sort of more dramatic, and then this YouTube comedy stuff where I can directly talk about social issues and change. My most recent film was a film called Nico that takes place in Tulsa. Most of it was shot in Kendall Whittier and then also downtown Tulsa. And it's a thriller that takes place with the homeless Native community, which is another community that is definitely here, but sort of gets overlooked. And, you know, my whole goal has been to highlight communities and people that are overlooked. And I think that's the one thread that sort of goes throughout my work. So, thank you.
I'm Teresa Reed, and I'm a professor of music at the University of Tulsa. I teach courses in music theory, music history and literature, and African American music. My own performance background is both classical and gospel and jazz. Formative musical experiences in the Black church, so my earliest performance experience was gospel. I did my college music experience as a saxophonist, and later and continued also to sing in gospel choirs and that sort of thing. In my teaching in African American music, I taught over the years three separate courses, Black American Musical Experience, which is general from West Africa, the present time course, History of Rhythm and Blues, which I will be teaching beginning on Wednesday, and History of Black Gospel Music. I've written two books. My first book is The Holy Profane, Religion in Black Popular Music, which argues that African Americans have used secular musical forms to convey their religious sensibilities. And my second book is The Jazz Life of Dr. Boone Taylor, whom I was the ghostwriter. And happy to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Hey, my name is Pete Brennan, and I am a theater artist. And I'm probably unique in my position in that while I've been in the theater world and an active member of the community for the majority of my life, I just recently, probably in the last 2 years, started to cultivate and examine what my personal artistic voice is. I started off as a performer and I graduated from TU, there's this like kind of mantra in theater and acting specifically, it's one of the only art forms where you have to actively ask permission to do your art by way of auditioning, and I think in so many ways a lot of performers in New York, or if you're just doing it professionally around the world or in the United States specifically, very oftentimes singers and dancers and actors and any kind of performer that is a part of the commercial world, the world that makes you money, you feel like a cog in the machine. So after college, I performed for several years on cruise ships as an acrobat and aerialist and dancer and singer. And then when I returned stateside, I was fortunate enough to do a couple national tours of Broadway musicals. And throughout that whole experience, you know, you just kind of start to get the feeling that you really are replaceable, and you start realizing that you're not really saying anything specific what you're doing. You're kind of, you're no more artistic than the easel that the painting sits on, because you're just placating another person's money-making thing, if that makes sense. So, through all that and witnessing kind of like the politics that go into casting and the microaggressions and discrimination that happens toward people of color and trans people, even in the theater world, which is meant to come across a very inclusive and open-minded community. I went to grad school. I decided to go pursue my master's in musical theater at the Boston Conservatory. And even there, it just kind of reaffirmed a lot of my thoughts that I mean, it was a very white-centric school. There was very little ethnic diversity there. It just got to the point where I didn't feel like the boiling point was reaching me, that I wasn't really part of anything important. And at the end of my first year there, it was kind of one of the, you know, formative times in our country in the last several years. Like, there was the Pulse nightclub shooting. And then within that same week, the Brock Turner case was, the ruling for that came out, and I just kind of had this crisis of conscience, and I was like, what am I doing? What's the point of any of this? I decided to leave the program and come back to Tulsa and kind of start to do what I could on a grassroots level in Tulsa, being a Tulsa native and knowing the dynamics of what the city is, still being a very segregated community as far as locations and where people live. So so in kind of experiencing that side of commercialism in the arts, I've just recently kind of started to form my artistic vision, which is through writing and directing. So the last couple of years I started writing for marginalized communities, and it started to become one of those things where I was tired of, I didn't want to play into the narrative of white guys telling other white guys' stories. So this past summer I wrote and performed a show at Summer Stage called Seeking Shelter about homeless people and the demographics that find themselves in that position more prevalent than others. And my passion is just to continue directing and choreographing and writing for marginalized communities and give people voices that don't normally have the opportunity to voice themselves.
Okay, so we're getting much closer to the time when you're going to start talking to one another. So you can start that process by, you have, some of you do social media, yes, Facebook, Instagram, those Twitter things. Feel free to start posting now, because this is the last time you're going to hear from them before you talk to one another. But you can share with the rest of the world, because they're going to talk for about 2 minutes each, and just, they're going to connect some of the artwork with whatever you do. You've already heard a lot about what they do. So they're going to connect as best they can with, how does my work relate to some of the backdrop artwork in this room. So in 2 minutes, they're going to share everything. And you're going to listen, and then after they're finished, then you're going to sit with four or five people. They're going to take your chairs, and you're going to get a little circle and talk to one another. And then you're going to share what resonated with you. So think about two or three things that really stood out to you. If you have paper, write it. If you know, Twitter, send me Twitter, Facebook, whatever. So about 2 minutes each.
Okay, so, like I said, seeking shelter is about homeless people. So, there's a play that I'm working on right now. It's called Chase of White, and I have the privilege of playing a Polish person, a Jewish Polish person. It's about Tulsa, actually. It's an original play written by a Tulsan, examining Islamophobia in the 90s in Tulsa, and it touches on the Tulsa race riots. And as you can see, Sonia Clark, she is very, very in tune with that sort of statement, and her artwork is, I saw Joyce speak both times, but Sonia's, not that, she's incredible, all of her stuff is incredible. Sonia's work really touches me, especially that American flag right behind you all. But yeah, just examining the kind of systemic oppression that happens regardless of whether we acknowledge it or not, and it stems from way before when that flag was flying over battlefields, but it's, and it still exists now.
Okay, so I could say the same thing about several of Joyce Scott's pieces. What she tends to do is use, for lack of a better word, describing a really beautiful distortion. So many of her pieces seem to be exhibit a lot of tension, distortion, sort of almost a beautiful agony about them. And she also addresses, I think, in that tension, the question of double consciousness. So in my work, both as an educator and as a writer and performer of African American music, the double consciousness of attention is there. One of the characteristic features of jazz, for example, is the necessity for the music to be off the beat, for it to be syncopated, the necessity for the music to blend notes and to be between notes and to incorporate improvisation and the unexpected and the unresolved. The lack of resolution is part of what makes jazz jazz, and I think that is very resonant and parallel with a lot of what particular Joyce Scott does. I'm intrigued by the piece here because with the blonde and the black hair, the first thing I thought about with that was getting my hair pressed as a little girl. And the purpose of that was to straighten my hair and make it more Caucasoid, although we didn't think of it that way when we were little. But if you're an African American woman, you probably have the experience of sitting between your mother's knees next to the stove, the flame, and the hot compressor pump. And the statement here again harkens back to this tension between double consciousness. So the tension in the art or the visual artwork is parallel to the tension we find in much of our music.
I mean, what I see is, just from glance around the room, it's changing the narrative about what America is. And that's something that I've faced here in Tulsa, but also like in my work. When I first moved to Tulsa, I expected it to be this really progressive, inclusive place. And I was like, wow, I'm going to the big city, you know? And I moved here and I was really blown away by the segregation. And I come from rural Oklahoma, you know, like you would think, like the stereotype that we have in rural Oklahoma is like rednecks, racist, you know, like very small-minded, but it couldn't have been the opposite, more opposite. We had to be there, every race of people there. And it was pretty much divided Native American, African American, and white. And we all had classes together. We were all neighbors. And so we learned how to communicate with each other. We learned how to be with each other. And we learned about each other's families. We learned about each other's histories. And so when I came to Tulsa, I was a little blown away at first by the just even like walking down the street in the unfriendly manner in which I was addressed, or like not addressed, more like I should say. And so when I first got here, I was a little freaked out because I was like, wow, this does not feel like a very open-minded place. And I've since gotten used to it, and I've come to terms and found peace with it, you know, and as we all do. But that really blew me away. So like in my work that I feel like I can connect with what the artist is doing here, is like, and kind of with what you do as well, is I made a film about music. It's a documentary. It's called This May Be the Last Time. And it was on Netflix, not anymore. I think it's going to be back on there at some point, but who knows. I think it might be on iTunes. I don't know if you can find it at all. But, so we have these songs, and we call them Creek Hymns. And it's a fascinating history. It tells you the whole story of America wrapped in these songs. And you can trace them to, in the film, I trace them to slave spiritual songs, Muskogee Creek songs, because we're from Alabama, Georgia, Mississippi. You know, we had a hand in the blues and the jazz and all that, but we're taken out of that history because we were physically taken out of that part of the world. And we were marched here. By the time we got to Oklahoma, we were naked and dying, and a lot of us died on the way. And that was not long ago. Like, in terms of history, like, that was not long ago. We got here in like 1853, I think. And Tulsa was founded by the first people to settle. Tulsa was Muskogee Creek Indians. Tulsa comes from the word Tallahassee, which means old town in our language. You would never know that walking down these streets. And so I constantly try to put that in people's faces and just explain to them. My daughter goes to Booker T. Love that school. They had a well-meaning, but almost, you know, it was really well-meaning, but it didn't work. It was like cultural day they used to have. It was like, dress up as your favorite culture, and it's kind of an inclusive thing. Which, you know, from all the stirring that I hear right now, you know that it goes bad. Like, you got kids in sombreros, and people are dressed like Indian princesses and things. And my daughter, we were excited about it, and my daughter got asked to give a welcoming in our language. And so she dressed in what our people wear, women wear right now, which are like ribbon skirts. She wore a ribbon skirt and a jean jacket and like a collared shirt underneath that. And she gave a welcoming in our language to open this day. And all of the kids were like, you're not dressed Indian. You don't look Indian, you know? It's like, she was literally the only person there dressed as a Native person. How we really dress, you know? So I constantly just try to put those images out, because those images aren't there. And somebody has to fill that void. You know, people argue about mascots and things like that. And that's why they're important, because they do give you this skewed vision of what Native people are. And so I try to create those images to fill that void, is what I try to do. The songs that I was talking about, though, there's only a few groups that sing this style called line singing. There's like in the Scottish Highlands, there's people that sing in this style because they couldn't read. A lot of people couldn't read. The priests could read. And so they would sing a line out, and then the congregation would sing that line back to them. You hear that in African American songs. But what people didn't really know, especially in music history, is like you can hear that right now in Oklahoma, and I can point you to every church that they still sing like that in. And when we first got here to Oklahoma, we blamed Christianity for what happened to us. And so we kicked out a lot of the white missionaries. And so to fill the gap for the Christians that still wanted to worship, African American preachers started preaching. And we started sharing churches with African Americans. So we split down the middle, Native and African American. And their stories, we have songs to this day that are half in Creek and half in English. And their stories that back in the day, in the 1800s, they would sing, one side would sing a verse, and then the other side would sing in their language. And so there was an English version, and then there was a native verse. And you can still hear those songs sung today. And so our story in America, our story in Oklahoma, is a very inclusive story. And to deny that, or to try to, like our president's doing right now, to act like, you know, we didn't build this all together is wrong. And so I try to combat that through my work, I think. And that's what I see in this work here.
For me, I'll begin with this and I'll talk about two bodies of work. I have this sort of, I've given myself this name of an Ethiopian explorer of the American West. And that is sort of influenced heavily by Manifest Destiny. So what does Manifest Destiny look like for brown people? Even though Manifest Destiny was actually, the actual means of moving was built by Chinese people, the construction of the railroad, right? But they were never part of the narrative. So, as an Ethiopian explorer then, I traveled around the U.S., explored the American West as I came here in the late 90s, right? So I was rather too late to the American exploration. And yes, it's a rather a very foolish thing to say that I'm an American. I am an Ethiopian explorer of the American West because I don't have a patrons that would send me to go to the American West and document. And photography, painting has been used to document that American West expansion. And I love that that narrative. And so what would be the stories of those that were excluded? And what were they excluded? Were they not capable of doing that? So that is one work that I relate to this. I don't know what the title of that work is, but I have a body of work collaborative self. It is a body of work where I photograph my subjects dressed in Ethiopian clothing, and then it is. First, let me say this: photography has been good excuse for me to go into communities and you're accepted because you're a photographer. But I kind of made it a little bit complicated by asking people to dress in the clothing that I carry with me. That particular work has been influenced by Edward S. Curtis. He is an American photographer that sort of documented this vanishing ways of Native Americans. So then collaborative stuff for me then was dress people in Ethiopian clothing, photograph them, give them my camera to photograph me dressed in Ethiopian clothing. So we had this sort of huge, cryptic work that showed an Ethiopian, or me, black, the American citizens in somewhere out in the American prairies, right? So the question was challenging, where was this image manufactured? Was it in the U.S.? Ethiopia or Africa. But so, and then I took this images were put together as one piece. So when I look at that, I see sort of that resemblance of carbon itself. So in all, what I see is this idea of acknowledgement or lack of acknowledgement of a certain people from American narrative. Particularly when I see the Latin flood, the bleached out. I see a lot of conversation that's happening, and that I sort of resonate with me as well. Oh, good. The collaborative stuff is yes, the Native American versus. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you. And I think someone from OCCJ is coming forward to get us into our groups, but I think so. Is that Sarah? So as you are thinking about things that resonate with you, just start coming up with your ideas of what was standing out to you for what you've heard and that you want to share with someone.
I'm gonna just kind of group you. I'm the system right now, the system that Wayne was talking about. So I'm gonna group you into your system where you can talk about what the artist has spoken about. So if we can have you five together here, and then the four of you together, and then if we can have you four together in this row, and then if we can have. Together, and then if you two can join this group, that'd be great. And then if we can have this. this back row, and if you two can move with the other participants back there.
Collaborate with us and to have a very, very strong input to what we were doing so that it did not come across, hopefully, in a negative, I'm telling your story way. So, in that vein, going forward, and I know it'll be a constant thing to be very, very wary of, going forward, I believe that the only way to collaborate is to truly get in the mind of the people that I'm hoping to share their stories. And that includes just letting them have a voice and listening. And I think as an ally that's constantly growing and figuring out how to navigate my voice as a white man in this landscape, the best thing we can do is listen and take in all the information we can and listen to the people people who have something to say to us. So I'm going to stop talking on that.
Briefly,
I've never talked with you. So I made a film, like I said, about homeless native people in Tulsa. And it's a thriller that takes place in that world. And the way to approach a community that you don't belong to, even though I'm native, I'm not a native person that's homeless. The way to reach a community like that is to empower them as well. And then you leave something with them. You're not just taking from them and bouncing out, you know, and you're not just telling your story and leaving. You're leaving them with tools to also inspire themselves to tell stories. I started working with the, I started eating at the Iron Gate soup kitchen and meeting folks there. And 75% of the actors are real people from the streets. And they were just so empowered and like happy to be able to tell a story that they connected to and also to be a part of it, that I always worried about the exploitative nature of doing that at first. But once I empowered them, then they would have my back. You know, like they wouldn't let anybody say that I exploited them because of what I gave them, you know, I still carry that today. So I think empowering people is important. And sorry, I thought that was for everyone at first, but.
Okay, this one, and we're on a schedule, so we're trying to get you out by 8 o'clock, so that's why we're sort of moving along. I do have a question that we'll ask for Dr. Reed. Based on the stories of others being misappropriated, how do you authentically tell or portray the story of another when it is not your own story or experience?
I think you can tell your version of what you believe their story is, and you can do that with integrity and with transparency and authenticity, but nobody can really tell their own story unless it's in their own voice. You know, and I think you can get into very specific meanings and definitions and really, you know, dissect very carefully what all that means. But in the same way, I'm going to give you an analogy. My husband and I have been married for 22 years. And I still can't read his mind and speak for him and say what he's thinking. And I know him very, very well. So I think that it's equally impossible for an artist or a writer or a musician or a sculptor or a photographer to really do any better than give their best version of what they perceive to be someone else's story.
Does anybody know what a photo voice is? Photo voice.
Oh, voice.
Yes. So, okay, photo voice is a process of a photographer. I use that as a tool. Basically, whatever community that you go into, you don't tell a story. As a photographer, that's really difficult. I don't photograph. So I empower that community to tell the story themselves. All I do is facilitate. So this, I'm a PhD student now, and I use photography as my method of doing my research. And so photo voice has been, I've been using photo voice as a tool where that community will tell me the story. I'm just a facilitator, right? So yes, there's a bias, and I have to stay that bias. And I agree with you, I've been married for 22 years and can still, right? There are things that you cannot completely understand. But there are certain things that you don't understand. So how do us artists, as sort of, how do we then be conscious of our own intentions, right? We are biased. The way I see things are completely different. I see things as a black male in America. But what does that mean for a Latina or even a white person, a white woman, and so forth, right? So be conscious of your own biases. Address that,
this question, we will have brief answers from everyone. So what has been a rewarding or memorable experience you have had with someone who has seen or experienced your work?
And we'll go all the way to
Something else I did this summer, Theater Tulsa, every summer they do an education series, a show, and I directed and choreographed In the Heights, which is a musical by Lin-Manuel Miranda about a neighborhood of primarily Latinx people in Upper Manhattan. And to make sure that we had an appropriately diverse cast, I went into a couple schools, TPS, to recruit kids. And we scholarshiped them because it was a camp that cost money, which hopefully in the future will change. But we scholarshiped kids to make sure that they were just able to experience this. And part of the reason I decided to kind of step away from acting was because I get so much more fulfillment watching other people do great things and trying to help them do that. So his name was Q, his real name is James, but he went by Q, and he was our Benny, which is the male love interest in this story. And he's been in a few shows at his high school. This camp was just a whirlwind of quick, what I thought to be very few learning opportunities, because we were just on a timeline and we had to get the show done, but he came to me afterwards and said that it was his favorite theater experience he's ever been a part of. And having like a young African-American man tell me that, and that I was able to help him experience that was really empowering to me, and I hope to him. So that was fulfilling to me and exciting to me. And that's kind of, okay, your turn.
Well, my answer is pretty mundane. I mean, I teach music, that's what I do, and probably more than any particular moment on the stage, what's most meaningful to me is when I connect with my students and use music to teach music in ways that remove the intimidation and the barriers and the anxiety. And one of the things I teach, aside from music history and literature, and African American music, I teach ear training and music theory, which are things that students typically don't necessarily like to do. And I enjoy bringing my whole self into that experience. And not on stage and not in front of hundreds or even thousands of people. It impacts the group that I'm interacting with in that moment. But that's deeply meaningful to me. That doesn't, that's not sexy, but that's my
Exactly. Honestly, I mean, there's been so many, as a filmmaker, you have a lot of people coming up to you afterwards talking to you about how, because if you're doing your job, people are connecting on a personal level, and they kind of interpret it to their life. So I've had a lot of people talk to me. One of the most memorable was, the second feature film that I made, it premiered at Sundance, and it played at, in Vancouver. They were showing it in Vancouver. No, I was there with my comedy group. But this woman, so the film's called Barking Water, and it's about this couple, they're an older couple, and they've been in this on and off relationship for 30 years. We meet them at the hospital, and the man is dying. So we go from the very first image that he's dying. The woman comes back to see him in the hospital, and she breaks him out of the hospital, and it's a road movie. She's trying to get him home to see his grandbaby that he's never met before he dies. And so really it's about their relationship and kind of unpacking all the stuff and the issues that they had and all of this. And really it's a story, it's her story. So I went to Vancouver for this booth, my comedy group, and this woman picked me up from the airport, and she said, I volunteered. She was a Native woman from Canada, from one of the reservations up there. She said, I volunteered to pick you up because I wanted to talk to you about your film, Barking Water. She said, I saw it in Toronto a couple years ago, and she said, I just knew she was telling me that she loved it, and she said that She said, it allowed me to forgive my father. And she said, my dad was just like that. And she said, it reminded me of these men, a lot of these Native men, this older generation. And it humanized him, and it made me realize that he had all this stuff going on. And he probably wanted to connect with me, but he couldn't. And then our car broke down, and it started raining. And this like really sweet, like these two Mormon kids pulled over and helped us push the car off the main road onto a side street. And then I got like a cab and got whisked away, and that was it. And then later, she introduced us on the stage, and she told this story, and she said, my dad used to always want to take dirt roads or back roads because he had warrants and things like that. She said, so when we broke down, I thought that was him. My dad was broke down. So she was just like thanking me for allowing her to forgive her father, which is like one of the coolest things anybody could ever say.
So there has been so many times that I've been told. And you know, as an artist, you create a body of work, you question when you make it, and then you doubt if anybody even resonates with the work that you create. So I have a body of work, I've been to a museum. It is it's a collaborative self project. And as an Ethiopian immigrant, we are trained to go to school to be engineers, doctors, or not an artist. So for me, it was so fulfilling to see an Ethiopian come to this talk that I was giving this summer and actually resonate with work. On the same talk, there was an Indian American from India, who loved the body of work and complimented about this idea of dressing in cultural clothing that he hated as a child and growing up. And once he saw the work, that body of work on the right, yes, where the resemblance of in Indian communities. And he just told me that he would start to wear his clothes from us, all in public. So he was born here. So there was a stigma of wearing his Indian name, a native clothes. So I think that was a huge compliment for me, because I always wonder who on earth will connect with that body of work. And so, yeah, I mean, you gotta connect with it.
Thank you. And we have one more question, I think. So these artists have been wonderfully insightful. So what we're going to do is, you know, when you look at art, you always ask the question, what am I going to do with this new understanding? What am I going to do to make the world, we hope, better, not worse? The same would be okay, but not worse. Better is preferable. So, as an artist, how do you challenge people to be agents of change in their own communities? As an artist, how do you challenge people to be agents of change in their own communities? We'll just start with you, Robin.
Okay, before I set the middle. Well, so last summer, I worked, we did a project on the Northeast Oklahoma City. Northeast Oklahoma City is where African American communities live, the most concentrated African American communities. So the idea was to, We were interested in identifying women. How do women make sense of Northeast Oklahoma City? What are places that they feel safe, and what are places that are threatening to their well-being? And this is based on the incident with a police officer
and I want to say about a year, 2 years ago, the committed crime against people of color. And so we were trying to figure out how does an environment foster for criminal activities. So for us, it was very important, as a man, trying to tell a story of women is in itself a problematic way of dealing with that issue. So we used photo books, which was basically telling truth to power. So we met in the summer, last summer, and they went into the Northeastern community and they photographed their own communities. It's not just about photographing their own communities, but we also facilitated for them to come and tell us the stories. Not only telling us the story, but how did they feel about making these images? And what were the things that were going? So we sat down and collected themes with the women of all the things that they were experiencing collectively as women of that community. Anyways, eventually, this body of work was exhibited at the City Hall in Oklahoma City, which was basically Northeast Oklahoma City is rather very much neglected. I don't want to say maybe like North Oklahoma. Thank you. Okay. And it was rather very inspiring watching the constituent leaders, the mayor, interact with these women in a space that they would normally not interact. So I think that is, right. I think that the women told their own narratives about how they came into that space, right? And you know that exhibit has been traveling in the last year throughout the city, and the women were on the forefront of addressing how do they want to exhibit, what images do they want to choose, so they would include their own images into the exhibit. And I think that was, as a photographer, for me, that was a hard thing not to be able to do, right? I love to photograph people. It's an excuse into other people's life. Yeah. But
no, I agree. I mean, I do a lot of youth workshops and travel and teach young people film and things like that. And you have to make a situation where they're not afraid to tell the truth. Because as artists, it doesn't always benefit us financially to tell the truth. We might not always get invited to speak on panels if we tell the truth. And the only way to really change, I mean, Nina Simone did not tell the truth, like Bob Dylan told the truth. Like, they weren't always praised for telling the truth, because sometimes the truth really hurts. The Brady District, you change the name of the Brady District, And you all have to put up air quotes when we say that, And we all know why. And whenever I was working at this land, we were lucky enough that someone put money behind us to let us say whatever we wanted to say. And that had to be the truth. And so you're not always going to get, it's not always financially lucrative to tell stories about Native Americans. We are 1% of this population. They're not throwing money at us to tell stories. I got quoted in this this article for a documentary magazine. Somebody asked me about Standing Rock, because there's a lot of documentaries about Standing Rock right now. And the quote, to quote myself, which is an awful thing to say, but it was if I had a dollar for every non-native making a Standing Rock documentary that asked me to be an executive producer on it, I would have enough money to make my own Standing Rock documentary. And so the only thing that I would say is it's not always, gonna benefit you as an artist, but the truth will always win in the end, and you have to keep fighting to tell that truth. If you're telling the truth, then nothing bad can happen to that in the end. You will win,
I
can
spend a really long answer to that in a nutshell, the way that I most effectively empower my community is
yeah. Something I think very tangible that I'm actively working on to empower my community is having to do with the Oklahomans for Equality, the center. They are about to open a brand new black box theater. And I'm running for the board, but that's beside the point. But in doing so, in my interview, I kind of gave them a bullet point of everything that they could do with that theater, include like the kind of programming they could include, the outreach they could implement, and my whole stance on the LGBTQ plus movement is that the only way to keep it going is to make it intersectional, as intersectional as possible, and join forces with our brothers and sisters of color, and there are feminist sisters, and so I gave them a bullet point list, and I'm in contact with the leaders of that organization on a regular basis. Additionally, the theater community, I am constantly pitching ideas and getting in there and talking about shows that could really make a difference. And I think that's a very tangible way that using my experience as a theater artist is translating to a better community, hopefully.
Can we give our panelists a hand?
She's there and now facilitated for us. So thanks again for being here.